From the air, Paris is the same magical collection of monuments that always greets the riders at the end of their three-week, 3,500-kilometre trek. On the ground, it's a more nervous, tightly monitored affair as the most French of all sporting institutions takes account of recent French history. Hello, if cycling is the most accessible sport in the world to the public, which it is, and the Tour de France is the biggest bike race in the world, which it is, then it follows that what to us is the final celebratory Sunday on the Champs-Élysées is a giant headache to the security services. And having acknowledged their giant headache, we'll leave it to one side and concentrate on our celebration, starting with the man who's celebrating his third Tour de France title.
Here's cycling's riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. Off the bike, shy and self-effacing. On it, utterly ruthless. Stylish, never in a month of Sundays. But effective, that'll now be three Sundays in July and counting, stood in yellow on the Champs-Élysées. Chris Froome is surely one of Britain's best known athletes, and yet we really have no idea of what makes him tick. Time for some illumination.
He's an incredible fighter. He's just, when he sees an opportunity, he takes it. And he never ceases to amaze, does he? You know, and I think it just demonstrates why he's the champion that he is.
The traditional knock on Froome has always been the same criticism that has always been levelled at Sky. All about the what's, never what the hell.
And now there's an attack and a big concerted effort here.
Until this year, when he has gone hell for leather and hung the consequences.
Chris Froome is riding himself to a stage win and the yellow jersey on stage eight.
You didn't see that coming.
Neither did anybody else.
That show of panache was maybe even trumped by his jumping off the front of the peloton to bridge to Peter Sagan on the run into Montpellier.
It's another statement of how strong and how self-confident and how full of belief the yellow jersey of Chris Froome is.
Only the third time in history that green and yellow have crossed the line in first and second. We've also seen him meting out punishment to those impudent enough to get in his way. And the madness of Mont Ventoux.
Chris Froome is running up Mont Ventoux without a bike.
Whether he should or should not have lost all that time became a moot point come the time trials. Froome was machine-like, a yellow thresher shredding the opposition. And on the treacherous descent of the Monte di Bisan on stage 19, Froome went down hard. With no team car behind, he had to ride the last 12 kilometres on teammate Geraint Thomas's bike. Testament to his racing instinct and a keep calm and carry-on attitude. The bloodied yellow jersey may have finished that day in ninth place, but bizarrely, he actually extended his lead. No wonder this new generation of GC rivals seemed to be almost in awe of him. Quintana, Mollema, Yates and Aru, all faithful hounds attempting to stick to his back wheel, but none possessing the strength of mind or leg to attack. And of course, most of the credit for that has to go to Sir Dave Brailsford's black and blueprint for success. First of all, no co-captains or sprinters to muddy the waters. One stated goal, the Maillot Jaune. Then once in yellow, a straightforward strategy. Providing they contain no threats to the GC, breakaways allowed to stay away with those big engines, Stannard, Rowe and Kiryenka pulling the sky train along. And when the road went up, Pauls, Aynal, Nieve, Landon, Thomas to the fore, safe in the knowledge that it would be nigh on impossible to sustain an attack off the front when the Sky boys were pumping out their 400 plus watts. So perhaps then, no mystery after all, just the story of a supreme talented and driven cyclist at the very peak of his powers, supported by a team of Galacticos, all with clearly defined roles. Maybe the only real surprise is why Sky keep talking about those marginal gains. With Chris Froome, who needs them anymore?
Just an amazing feeling, absolutely amazing. It could be the first tour all over again for me. Again, just all those emotions coming down that final descent, just the suspense, obviously, of not putting a foot wrong and making sure I just got down there safely. But coming into that last kilometre with my teammates around me, just that feeling of happiness, relief, 3 weeks of really just every day putting everything on the road. Coming down to today is just an amazing feeling.
Right, let's check the last classification but one before we go any further. Chris Froome lost time on the Champs-Élysées last year by dropping back to finish in formation with his team, so his winning margin of 4 minutes 5 seconds over Romain Bardet might drop. Nairo Quintana is third at 4:21. Adam Yates is fourth and the last man within 5 minutes of the winner. Richie Porte is fifth and trying not to think about his Stage 2 puncture. Alejandro Valverde sixth. Joaquin Rodriguez seventh in his farewell tour. Louis Meintjes eighth. Dan Martin ninth. And Roman Kreuziger tenth after his attack yesterday. Seven of the eight British riders who started the race finish it, Mark Cavendish being the exception. Geraint Thomas finishes 15th in Froome's service. His teammates Luke Rowe and Ian Stannard 152nd and 163rd. Steve Cummings is 142nd with a superb stage win. And Daniel McClay didn't just make it round on his debut, he was up there with the best sprinters in the world with a third place, his best result. Two British riders will be on the podium at the end of the day. Froome in yellow, Adam Yates in the white of best young rider.
It's only my second Tour de France, I'm still 23. Yeah, this is just the beginning. It's not like, I'm not just about to retire or anything. So, I'll be back in the future and for sure I'll try and fight for the podium. And if not more, so, satisfied and on to next year.
And of course, he might well have been on the podium if it hadn't been for a collapsing kilometre banner. Now, a bit later on, Daniel will be giving some attention to the British riders in the race who've had less of it than others. In the meantime, let's get on with the final stage. And it's the shortest non-time trial stage of the tour, just 113 kilometres, as the organisers try to limit the amount of mucking about on bikes that takes place early in the stage and ruins everybody's scheduling. The action only starts once the race hits the finishing circuit after 57 kilometres. Eight laps of the Champs-Élysées with an intermediate sprint after 73.5 kilometres and the definitive one on the ninth crossing of the line. The thin blue Team Sky line have been turned yellow for the final stage. Bike still blue, shoe colour a matter of personal choice. Chris Froome has yet to match Bernal Hinault's five Tour wins, but he drew alongside him on the road for a congratulatory handshake. In both directions, Hinault about to retire from his role with the Tour organisation. There was bottled beer in preference to champagne, Chris Froome's round, and the rolling team pitcher, although the race leader did eventually give in to press photographer pressure and pose with a glass of something fizzy. We pick things up as the race arrives on the Champs-Élysées with a departing member of the peloton at the front.
But look now, the pressure. They've really got great form there as they are, in fact, putting daylight between themselves. There's a big move over on the right-hand side coming from Astana.
Well, as we're watching this race, Direct Energy getting control on the left of the road here. Jens, what do you think?
Well, they were brave taking their chance of taking a move because often it's better to control the peloton from the front than fighting behind for positions. But just now, everything has changed again. The Team Direct Energy with Thomas Kirkler did an attack in the middle. On the outside, you could see Astana having acceleration going on. So in the moment, it's not too much organization I can recognize here, just people all over the place.
I was going to say, that's an underestimation. This race is a mess for the sprinters right now. They are ducking and diving in every direction. They do not know which wheel to get onto.
Yeah, but on this final stage, you've got to bide your time. Chris Froome, he's biding his time. He's just waiting to get through the final few kilometres. He knows that very shortly he'll be crowned the winner. I can see a very big organised line of Etics Quickstep riders, Phil, in the second row. They're in positions 5 to 8. They're waiting for the right moment to open up the sprint, but to win the sprint here on the Champs-Élysées, you have to have as many men with you as possible to lead out the sprint, and that's why I've still got a little bit of confidence in Marcel Kittel, because his team still have an organised train. There they are on the left-hand side, but there's also Orica Bike Exchange up there as well. They're looking after them, and Michael Matthews.
We go round the back of the Arc de Triomphe for the last time now, and it's down the fast stretch. They try to reorganise themselves now, 4.6 kilometres out from the finish. And they're still trying to take time out. It looks to me like that could be Yoni Zagir at the front. Oh no, it's Orica Greenedge on the front here. They're so similar, those team jerseys.
Well, I can also spot moving to the front in second position there, Roman Kreuziger. He did a massive ride yesterday to try and move up in the overall standing. Chris Froome here, Phil, he's not enjoying this speed on the far side of the Champs-Élysées. He's trying everything he can just to stay in contact in the peloton. Such is the speed as we wind ourselves up for the sprint. But bear in mind, he's got a good buffer. He's got four. Oh, there's a crash there on the right-hand side.
Well, what happened there? That was a very heavy fall, and it was an IAM cyclist who went down. Well, There's no rain out there. I don't know. I was looking down at the time of the fall, but he went down for sure as the race gets on at full bore.
Well, in fact, it's caused a little bit of a split in the main field. And bear in mind, Phil, Chris Froome was at the back of the main peloton when a crash happened, so he could see himself losing a little bit of time.
Well, let's see where Chris is. He's got plenty of time in hand. Once we get to 3 kilometres to go, Chris has won the Tour de France, because the time will end at that point for this big pack of riders if there is a problem such as a crash.
Well, there's another crash happened, and we're getting all of this information, Phil, not from the camera that we're looking through, but from race radio. A rider from Lotto Jumbo has also gone down. And Brian Coquart has had a flat tyre, the Frenchman.
Brian Coquart, after all of this work by Thomas Buckley in particular, has had a flat tyre 2.5 kilometres from the
finish. There he is.
Is there any justice? He won't lose any time. Do you think he cares? But now he just has to finish the race.
But the question now is, who survived? I can see the Norwegian flag just very close to the front, and that is Edvald Boasenhagen. I can see the green jersey of Peter Sagan. He's freestyling, if you like, just hanging around, swinging from wheel to wheel, looking for the fastest man to follow. It currently is sitting on the wheel of Michael Matthews from Orica Bike Exchange.
Everybody wants to win the last stage of the Tour de France. These boys are absolutely locked in now. As they're 1.8 kilometres from the finish. Jérôme Cousin, possible for the Cofidis team who have come through with Lotto. They're looking for Greipel in the white jersey, fifth in line, perfectly poised. Better check who's on his back wheel, Peter Sagan.
But he's got what he wants. He's got his perfect lead-out train. Look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4 riders from Lotto Soudal and Greipel sitting in fifth as they come out of the tunnel for the last time.
Around the Norwegian corner, they'll be cheering for Christoph. Down the bottom road, the boys are doing well. The Lotto team are laying this on for the man in white. They'll launch the last moment when they have to. Marcel Kittel's team in blue are coming up on our right. And on the left, even the Dimension Data are getting involved for Boysenhagen. And Boysenhagen is right there.
And also, Phil, right in the middle in the green is Peter Sagan. You've got Dimension Data. That's Bernie Eisel on Bernie Eisel's wheel. You can see moving up the Norwegian national champion. But you can also see Etix Quickstep looking around. Where's Marcel Kittel? I'm looking for my man.
Well, Katusha, the boys with the K are trying to lead out Alexander Kristoff, who told us before you've got to be in the first five around the last corner to win this stage of the Tour de France. He is in a perfect position. He's going to line up for the finish in second place, and locked onto his back wheel is Greipel, followed by Sagan. As they come up now, it's the last lead out to the line for Kristoff. Greipel is waiting. He's never lost. He's always won one stage in a Tour de France. Greipel is going to try and take on Alexander Kristoff. This is going to be the end of a perfect tour, unless... No, he doesn't. Greipel has done it. He completes another Tour de France where he's always won at least one stage, and this is his second win on the Champs-Élysées.
Phil, as a sprinter, if you're only going to win one stage in the Tour de France, this is the one that you want to win. His team brought it all together on the final few kilometres. Let's not forget, as we look there at André Greipel, that Chris Froome will cross the line somewhere in there as the winner. Here he is, right at the back with all of his teammates up alongside him. The Tour de France winner.
For the first time in this year's Tour de France, he's pulled them off the front and put them on the back to celebrate victory in the Tour de France. The third time for Chris Froome. A British team winning the Tour de France for the fourth time in 5 years with an individual rider. Amazing.
Well, there it is, Phil. After 3 weeks of racing around France, job done, but also job done for André Greipel. And I'll tell you what, did you see the skid at the back of Peter Sagan there, trying to get himself every last lit of power, trying to get it. This is the move. This is the move by Christoph in the red there. Greipel all of a sudden showing why he's still one of the greatest sprinters in the world. Coming back fast, fast, fast in the green jersey, but not quite fast enough. Second place for Peter Sagan. What a great finish to the final stage on the Champs-Élysées. André Greipel not getting it wrong this time. And of course, adding to that little record of his every year since 2011 that he's participated in the Tour de France, he's come away. Yes, well done, André, with a stage victory.
And in formation, purposely hanging back behind the sprint won by André Greipel from Peter Sagan and Alexander Kristoff. And so began the ceremonies, starting with a special one for the departing Ben Aino, five-time winner of the Tour and long-time servant of it since. Greipel made his second straight appearance on the Champs-Élysées podium, but last year's was a final flourish in a tour of four stage wins. This year's saved his tour. Peter Sagan picked up his fifth consecutive green jersey and was called back to receive the Tour's Most Aggressive Rider award too. His teammate Rafał Majka won the King of the Mountains jersey for the second time, and Adam Yates, who was in third place overall until stage 19, took the white jersey of best young rider.
Adam, congratulations. What was it like up there on the podium?
Yeah, it's an amazing feeling. It's not been easy these past few weeks. It's been a lot of suffering. But here we are, fourth on GC and in the white jersey. So, yeah, great honour. Hopefully I'll be back next year and do it all again.
No change in the final GC. There actually were splits, but the organisers put them in and then took them out. So all the time gaps exactly as they were this morning. And all seven British riders who started the day finished it. Which brings us on to the next colour in the sequence, yellow. Chris Froome flanked by Romain Bardet and Nairo Quintana.
My teammates and support team, this is your yellow jersey too. I wouldn't be standing here if it wasn't for your commitment and sacrifice. A massive thank you to Dave Brailsford and my coach Tim Kerrison. This is one special team and I'm so proud to be a part of it. To Michelle, my wife, and my son Kellen, your love and support make everything possible. Kellen, I dedicate this victory to you. This tour has obviously taken place against the backdrop of terrible events in Nice, and we pay our respects once again to those who lost their lives in this terrible event. Of course, these kind of events put sport into perspective, but they also show why the values of sport are so important to free society. We all love the tour because it's unpredictable, but we love the tour more for what stays the same. The passion of the fans from every nation along the roadside, the beauty of the French countryside, and the bonds of friendship created through sport. These things will never change. Vive le Tour et vive la France!
Merci à Christophe Froome, petite traduction des propos tenus.
So David Brailsford, a tremendous piece of national sporting history achieved here today. What's this moment like for you and the team?
Proud to be British, I'd say. We weren't a cycling nation not so long ago, and I think we are now. And it's been a great project. It's been great fun to be involved with all of the Tour de France's that we've won. It wasn't so great, but one that we didn't win. But I think Chris is a phenomenal, phenomenal, talented, you know, guy, and the way he's ridden this year has been the best. It's been the best team effort we've ever had.
After the podium 1-2-3, we got the four jerseys, and then we finally got our own word with Chris Froome.
You've made sporting history. What was it like up there on the podium in front of these crowds after your third Tour de France victory?
It could have been the first one all over again. Just the same kind of emotions. It's even though I've been here before, it hits you just how big this feels and just the atmosphere here on the Champs-Élysées.
And you've showed real sporting dominance. Eddy Merckx the other day said you're good for 4, 5, 6 Tours de France. What do you think you're good for, Chris?
I mean, that would be incredible. That would be absolutely amazing. I mean, I'd love to come back. Every time I ride onto Champs-Élysées, I think I can't wait to be back here again next year. So let's see.
Now, Mobistar may not have won the overall with Nairo Quintana, but they did win the team classification. Although unofficial team of the Tour went to the support unit of the yellow jersey, and as you can see here, it extended beyond the members of it who rode the bikes. And all ceremonial business. Now, it's usually at this point in the show that I shake Chris Boardman's hand and thank him for his company and you for yours. But Chris, as you know, had to leave us a couple of weeks into the Tour this year, so on the off chance that he's watching, I'll thank him and you the same way down the camera lens. Your thanks, as always, if you've enjoyed the coverage, should go to the people whose names are coming up in the credits. That is the 2016 Tour de France, and this is the final music sequence.
When your heart is broken down, down. And your head don't reach the sky. Take your broken wings and fly.